Student, last time we discussed about thermal conductivity. We tried to learn about the steady state. Now, in this session, we will discuss about the coefficient of thermal conductivity. Coefficient of thermal conductivity is a quantity, is a constant that is introduced in the proportionality equation, that is first let me draw the diagram and explain you. We will consider a rod and we will maintain different temperatures at the two ends. Then we allow the heat to flow from one end and it comes out to the other end. Now we have to specify some dimensions of the conductor. We'll consider that L is the length of the conductor, A is the area of cross section. The two ends are maintained at temperatures say T1 and T2 or theta 1 or theta 2. Obviously, if it flows from this end to the other end, this end must have higher temperature because heat flows because of the difference in temperature always flows from the body at higher temperature to the lower temperature end. Now, we will from the experiment, it was found the quantity of heat that flows. The quantity of heat will represent with Q, capital Q, that flows from one end to the other end of the conductor. Now, what are the factors on which Q depends? If Q depends upon A, B, C, D, or so many factors, then it depends directly or indirectly or power or without any power. Then we will have some proportionality equation. Then you, in terms of equation, if you want to write, then we have to introduce a constant. That constant is coefficient of thermal conductivity. We'll use the symbol K for this and see how this is done. So we have a let us say this is a conductor where A is the area of cross section, Q is the quantity of heat that flows. Theta 1 and theta 2 are the temperatures at the two ends of the conductor. A and B are the two ends. A is the area cross section. This is the area cross section that I have considered A. So this A is not area. This A I have taken as the name of the ends. Obviously, this A is also the area of the cross section. T is the time for which you allow the heat to pass. L is the length of this conductor. This length. Now, it is found from the experiment that the heat that flows through this conductor at steady state. Steady state means when it flows, no part of the material will gain temperature. The temperature will remain same. Okay? That means the theta 1 and theta 2 will not change as the heat flows through this, because this material is at steady state conditions. So it will just allow the heat to pass through it without gaining or absorbing heat, because if there is no absorption of heat, then obviously there is no rise in temperature of the of that part of the medium. So now what has been found from experiment that I write in the form of equation, then I'll explain. Now that the quantity of heat that flows through this depends upon a few factors, the length of this, the temperature difference between the two. If higher the temperature difference, the greater is the flow. Okay, more and more heat will pass through this in less time. If you, we allow time, greater time, so more time if you allow, more heat will flow. What about the length? Inversely related to the length. Because if this length is longer, then less quantity of heat will flow through this. If the length is smaller, then more and more quantity of heat will pass through that length. Okay, so it has been found that the quantity of heat that flows through the conductor is directly proportional to area cross section. That means if the area cross section is thinner, then the less quantity of heat will pass. If area cross section is large, then more quantity of heat will flow per second. So this is just like if you open a tap, if you have a tap with a larger hole, then more water will come out at a given instant. Like if from a water coming from a hose pipe, more water comes out at a time. And if the tap is very small, the area cross section is small, then less will come. So that depends. This is the flow of water in a pipe is similar to the, you can compare that to the flow of heat through a conductor. It is just a similar comparison. So if the area cross section is larger, more of the heat will pass through. So it is found that the quantity of heat that is flowing Q is proportional to the area of cross section of the conductor. Larger the area, more heat will pass. Then it is proportional to the difference of the temperature between the two ends of the conductor. The higher the difference, greater the heat flow. Then the time. Obviously, if you keep the water open for a long time, more water will come down. Similarly, if you allow the heat to flow for a long time, more heat will flow. And inversely proportional. This is a relation is a inversely proportional to L. Because its power is minus 1 or inversely proportional to the length. Greater the length, less heat will flow. Combining these four, what we have? Combining this, we have Q is proportional to A theta 1 minus theta 2 T divided by L. So all these three, all factors, if I consider those factors, then I have this proportionality and I can write this as Q proportional to, or in terms of equation, you can write this is equal to some constant divided by L, okay, where K is called the coefficient of thermal conductivity. This K and this one theta 1 minus theta 2 by L, this is called temperature gradient, okay, where K is the coefficient of thermal conductivity and is called temperature gradient. Okay, T is the time. Now, how to define this K? The definition of K is when you make everything else is 1, when you put A is 1, L is 1, T is 1, theta 1 minus theta 2 1, everything you make 1, the difference you make 1, then that K becomes equal to Q. So you can define K as is the amount of heat that flows through the conductor. Amount of heat that flows through the conductor of unit length whose area cross section is unity when it is maintained at unit temperature gradient. Okay, in 1 second. That means what? It is the amount of heat flowing per second through a conductor of unit length having unit area cross section maintained at unit temperature difference. So I'll write the definition and the unit of K here and also the dimension. Now Q is K A theta 1 theta 2 T divided by L. This is there. Now K is Q L divided by A so from here the unit of Q is joule joule per meter Kelvin second. Okay, this is the unit of K or calorie per meter Kelvin second, degree centigrade second. So in terms of the dimension, joule write m L square T minus 2 energy unit, and m here m is for meter, so it is length. Here K for Kelvin, S is for time second, so it is T. That is equal to this is the dimension of okay. Here the K means we are using a symbol, that is a coefficient of thermal conductivity, but here the K is the Kelvin, or you could write theta minus 1, some book T minus 1, K minus 1. So you can take K minus 1. Okay. That is the dimension. The definition, as I told you, it is defined as, I write the definition also for you. It is defined as the quantity of heat flowing through a conductor of unit length maintained at unit temperature difference having unit area cross section per second. That is, it is the heat flowing per second through a conductor of length whose length is you can say 1 unit, that is you can say 1 meter. And if you write everything is in SI unit, then length will be in meter. The temperature difference should be 1 Kelvin, the area of cross section should be 1 meter square, and time is 1 second. That means if I simply tell you, this is also important that at steady state, if I have a conductor of length 1 meter, whose area cross section is 1 meter square, the temperature here is suppose any temperature say theta 1, that is in Kelvin I can consider theta 1, here it is 1 plus theta 1, then the difference is 1, and I will allow time 1 second, how much heat comes out to it, how much heat flows through this, that is equal to K. So basically this physical significance is that if K value is more, that means more heat will flow, is a good conductor of heat, like copper, aluminium, they are good conductor of heat. So the greater the value of K implies the conductivity of heat is more, that is a better conductor of heat, mostly used for utensils for our cooking purposes. And these conductivities are due to the free electrons present. So the material having greater amount of free electrons are more are considered better conductors of heat. And because of this number of or availability of free electrons, the same thing is applied to electricity. They are also good conductor of electricity. So good conductors of heat are mostly good conductor of electricity. Okay, thank you.